This teaching you're about to listen to was preached by Jegede Sunday E and recorded live at God's Family Bible Church, Trinidad. Jegede Sunday E is the General Coordinator of Arabs of Revival Ministries and the School of Discipleship. He is also the Missionary Pastor of GFBC Trinidad under the leadership of Pastor Abolaji Akimbo, the General Overseer of God's Family Bible Church Worldwide, Palm Coast, Florida. Listen and be transformed.
Oh, our Father, we thank you. We thank you, Father, for the beautiful, awesome, precious gift of seeing eyes that you have given to us and hearing here. Father, we thank you for the ability that you have given unto us to see with spiritual discernment and to hear, to listen, to understand your instruction, the voice of your spirit. And so, Father, tonight we declare, Father, that Lord, as we look into the word of God, our eyes are open and we see with spiritual discernment what you are saying. We hear, we listen, we comprehend, we'll understand, and we'll obey and follow every instruction that you will give to us tonight. Father, we thank you. As your word go forth tonight, healing flow. Lord, as your word go forth tonight, wisdom flow, revelation, knowledge flow, utterances flow, the sick are healed. In the name of Jesus, the captives are free. Miracles happen in the name of Jesus. And Christ is glorified. And the church of God is edified and built up. We thank you. We celebrate the ministry of the Holy Spirit tonight. And we yield to you. We receive of you tonight. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. I want to hear you say amen. Amen. Glory be to God. Once again, thank you so much for being part of today's Bible study. This is Bible study, and that means we shall be studying the Word of God together. So I need you to get your writing material, get your notes, that is important, and also get your Bible by your side, and let's dig into the Word of God. Glory be to God. Tonight, God is posing a very simple but very vital question to you. And that is going to be the title of today's Bible study. This is going to be part one. And hopefully, next week, we're going to conclude on it. What is the question God is asking you today and which I will love you to answer even now? God is asking you, what do you see? What do you see? Now, this is going to be part one. And you know what? Pay attention tonight. I want you to answer that question. Even right now, get your note and answer the question God is posing to you. What do you see? You need to take note that God is not asking you, what are you looking at? That is not what God is saying. That is not the question God is asking you. But God is asking you, what do you see? When you look at your life, when you look at your experiences so far, the good, the bad, the ugly, the pleasant, and the unpleasant, when you look at things that have happened to you, your God is asking you, what do you see? When you look at your partner, when you look at your children, when you look at what is going on in your family, your home, your business, your ministry, when you look at your present challenges, when you look at your condition, perhaps you have a doctor report concerning your health condition. When you look at this, you look at your bank account, you look at your pocket, you look at things you don't have, you look at things that you are. God is asking you a question. What do you see? Now, you need to answer that. And what we are going to do in this Bible study is actually to see God's expected answer. So, but don't wait till that time. Answer God's question now. What do you see? I remember when I was in primary school, in America, we call it elementary school. All right. When our teacher Whenever the teacher give you an assignment, maybe an exercise, and then you get it wrong, right? Now, not only will the teacher give you the right answer or the correction, the teacher will see to it that you actually write out the correction. So the teacher will tell you, now this is the correction, I want you to go and do it and bring it back, and the teacher is still going to mark the correction as though that is the exercise that he has given you, all right? And that is exactly what we'll be doing, because that is what the word of God is. The word of God is for correction. 2 Timothy 3:16-17. So don't be afraid of answering the question. Answer the question. Write it down. What do you see as you look at your life? What do you see as you look at the world? As you look at what is going on, the ongoing pandemic, the ravaging of the COVID-19, your present struggle and challenges, the things you are dealing with, God is saying, what do you see? What do you see? All right? And this Bible study is actually, we are going to begin to see God's expected answer, the right answer. But I want you to know the word of God is for correction. That is why we study the word of God. 2 Timothy 3:16-17. 2 Timothy 3:16-17. Paul says, our scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God, the child of God, may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. All right. So the Bible study, don't be afraid of writing down, noting down your answer to God's question. What do you see? By the end of this Bible study, I believe we will have received correction. I strongly believe that we will be able to see the answer that God expected. And if that is not your answer, what do? Then you readjust. You make correction so that your answer can line up and conform to the exact thing that God wants you to answer. So what do you see? Not what you are looking at. Now, there's a huge difference between looking and seeing. That is important. Now, you see, in the world, many people look, all right, but only few people actually see. Many people are looking, but only few people are actually seeing. But listen to this now. But you know something? Only fewer people see very well. So there's a difference between looking and seeing. There's a difference between seeing and seeing well. Looking is simply a function of the eyes. All right? Now you look with your eye. Now looking is you just simply directing your eyes toward an object. But you see, seeing is much more deeper than that. Seeing is a function of the heart and the mind. You see with your heart, you see with your mind. Have you tried to point out someone in the midst of a crowd to someone by your side? Maybe a crowd not too far away, and then you begin to describe the person, and then you try to point out that person to another, and even though the person is looking at the exact direction that you point to, yet the person cannot see who you are describing. He said, I can't see her. And then you keep going on to describe the dress from the head to the toe, and eventually the person say, oh yes, I can see her. Yes, I can see. And then you say, so who do you see? And the person is describing someone else entirely. Maybe the person you are pointing at is someone that is dressed maybe in a royal blue or navy blue, and your friend is describing someone that is dressed in black. You say, no, that is not the person I want you to see. That is not the person I'm pointing out to you. And maybe if you go over the description again, eventually the person may see exactly who you are pointing out in the crowd. So you can see there's a difference between just looking and seeing. And there's a difference between seeing and seeing very well. God wants us not just to look, but to see, but not just to see, but to see very well. And this is also my desire and passion. This is actually why we are going through this Bible teaching series, so that we may be able to see very well what the Lord is doing this year, what the Lord is saying to us, what the Lord is showing to us. Now, as I said to you, sin is a function of the heart. Sin is a function of the mind. To see is to perceive mentally. To see is to envision. To see in your mind, to picture. Now, let me ask you this. Now, maybe you are at home, wherever you are watching us, connected with us, all right? Now, if you are not in your car, in your vehicle, and I say, could you please describe your vehicle to me? Even though you are in your home now, you are not in your car, but you see, you can vividly, clearly describe your car, your vehicle to me. Some of us will go to the essence of not just describing the type, the model, or the interior. We can even talk about the engine, all right? Even though you are not looking at the car, but the picture is in your mind. You are seeing it in your mind. So you see, that is what we call seeing. It is to see in your mind. You may not be looking at that thing, but the picture is in your mind. And as you talk about it, you can visualize it. You can imagine it. Glory be to God. Do you know something? To see is not just to picture something, to envision something. It is actually to know, to understand, to discern. Have you tried to make someone see a point, and then you go ahead and you argue, and then you talk and you talk? Maybe after 2 hours, the person say, "Oh, now I see what you are talking about." What does the person say? "Now I know. Now I understand your point. Now I get your point." So you see, to see is to know. To see is to be able to discern. To see is to comprehend. Glory be to God. And that is God's desire. That is my desire for you. That this year that is called our year of new things, our year of newness and recovery, that you also will not just look at what is happening in the world, but you are going to see exactly what God is doing. You are going to see what God has done. You are going to see what God is doing now in your life, what God is doing now with your life, and what God intends to do through your life. You are going to see the new thing that God has planned for you. Glory be to God. I hope you have your answer jotted down. Let's go. All right. So we're going to start by actually looking at a young man's response to this same question. This young man is Jeremiah. All right. Turn with me to the book of Jeremiah chapter 1. So when God posed this question to Jeremiah, I want you to see Jeremiah's response, and we are going to start from there. So Jeremiah chapter 1, what do you see? Jeremiah chapter 1, when you read from verse 1, the words of the Lord came to Jeremiah, the son of Hilkiah, the priest. All right, so the word of the Lord came to him in the days of 3 kings, Josiah, and the son of Josiah, Jehoiakim, and Zedekiah. All right, let's jump to verse 4. Then the word of the Lord came to me, Jeremiah speaking here, saying, "Before I form you," that is verse 5, are you there with me? Jeremiah chapter 1, make sure you open your Bible. This is going to be our main test, and it is important for you to see, all right, what the Lord is saying. So, verse 5, God now speaking to Jeremiah, "Before I form you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctify you." What does that mean? "I set you apart. I ordained you. I chose you. I appointed you. I anointed you a prophet to the nation." This is God setting before Jeremiah his purpose for his life. God here was revealing very clearly to Jeremiah what he was created for, who he was created to be a prophet to the nation. He was already set apart, anointed, chosen, appointed, equipped by God to fulfill this purpose. But look at verse 6 now. Jeremiah had not seen what God has already done. God had done it. He had sanctified him. God had chosen him. God had ordained him. God had anointed him a prophet to the nation. But Jeremiah was yet to see that. All right. So look at his response. See? Then said I, Lord God, behold. All right. He was asking God to see now, not seeing what God has said, not seeing what God was showing him. He was asking God to see what he was seeing. I cannot speak for I'm a youth. So Jeremiah was saying, God, I want you to see my inability. Jeremiah was saying, God, I want you to see my disability. I want you to see the hindrance, the obstacle. I want you to see that this is not possible. I cannot speak. Isn't that what we do also? Isn't that? Because when God shows us something, when God speaks, and you are unable to see it, you will always say, no, I cannot do that. I cannot have that. Why? Because you have not seen what the Lord has done. Because you have not seen what the Lord has said. Because you have not seen what the Lord is showing to you. But thank God for our good Father. He will not give up on all. So God will not give up on Jeremiah. Even though he was still spiritually blind to what God has done, to who God has called him, and to the ministry that God has set him apart for. So verse 7, but the Lord rebuked him. The Lord said to him, do not say, I am a youth, for you shall go to all whom I send you, and whatever I command you, you shall speak. Verse 8, do not be afraid of their faces. For I'm with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Verse 9, then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, behold, see, I have put my words in your mouth. Verse 10, God is calling him to see. See, I have this day set you over the nations and over the kingdom. I am putting you in position of authority to root out and to pull down, to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant. See how it is important for God, for Jeremiah to see what the Lord is showing, what the Lord is saying, to see God's purpose, God's plan, God's mandate upon his life. Now verse 11, please pay attention to verse 11. After this, God posed a question to Jeremiah. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me saying, Jeremiah, what do you see? Isn't that the question that God is asking us today? God is calling you by your name and God is asking you, what do you see? Okay, so let's see Jeremiah's response now. So Jeremiah replied, I see a branch of an almond tree. I see a branch of an almond tree. God asked Jeremiah, what do you see? All right. So that tells all that God was showing something to Jeremiah. God was pointing out something to Jeremiah. And let's see if Jeremiah passed God's test. Let's see if Jeremiah actually saw what the Lord wanted him to see. Verse 12. Then the Lord said to him, you have seen well. Also, he passed the test excellently. You have seen well, for I am ready to perform my work. This is my prayer for you, that by the end of today's Bible study, God will also say to you, you have seen well. So the purpose of this Bible study is to bring you to a point where you can see well. And when God asks you, what do you see? And like Jeremiah, when you respond, God is going to say, you got it right. That is excellent. That is awesome. You saw well. That is exactly what I wanted you to see. So God said to Jeremiah, you have seen well. I desire that God will say that about me. When he asks me, what do you see? I desire that will be God's response to you. When God asks you, what do you see? Jeremiah, you have seen well. So what does it mean to see well? Now, these are important questions that this Bible study will be answering. All right. So three vital questions. What does it mean to see well? Why should you see well? So what does it mean to see well? All right. And why should I bother to see well? And of course, we are going to also answer How can I begin to see well? So three questions we'll be answering in the course of this teaching. What does it mean to see well? Why should you see well? How can you see well? Or rather, how can you begin to see well? Are you ready for that tonight? Glory be to God. So let's jump on it. All right. So what does it mean to see well? We saw God asked Jeremiah, the scripture we just read, Jeremiah 1, 11 and 12, what do you see? And Jeremiah replied, I see a branch of an almond tree. And God said, you have seen well. So what does that mean? All right. Number one, two things I'm going to call your attention to. Very important. What it means. What seeing well implies. What it means to see well. All right. Two tests of seeing well. When will God say to you, you have seen well, just like he said to Jeremiah. Number one, I want you to know that seeing well is seeing what God sees. Very important. So seeing well is me, is you, seeing exactly what God sees. Or rather, it is seeing what God wants you to see. It is seeing exactly what God is pointing at. It is seeing exactly what God is showing to you, what God is saying to you, what God is revealing to you. That is what it means to see well. Can you imagine God pointing out or revealing a branch of an almond tree to Jeremiah? And God asked, Jeremiah, what do you see? And then Jeremiah said, I see a branch of a peach tree. All right. You know, peach tree is very close, resemble almond tree. So if Jeremiah said, I see a branch of a peach tree, he will have failed woefully, because what God was showing to him is a branch of an almond tree, not a peach tree, even though it looks like a peach tree, even though it resembles a peach tree, but it is an almond tree. A branch of an almond tree. So how did Jeremiah pass God's test? He saw exactly what God was showing. Not something similar. Not something close. Exactly what God was showing to him. That is important. So seeing where is you seeing what God is saying, what God is showing, what God is revealing, what God is seeing. That is seeing well, all right? So when I look at my life, when I look at my situation, when I look at my condition, when I look at challenges, when I look at my struggles, when I look at the obstacles, and listen to this, if I see exactly what God will see or what God is seeing, as God look at me in that condition, in that situation, in that circumstance, then I am seeing well. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? So the big question is, when God look at me, when God look at my life, when God look at my struggles, my challenges, my situation, when God look at my mistakes, all right, what does God see? Now, that is an important question, because seeing well is seeing what God sees. So if seeing well is seeing what God sees, I better know what God sees. So what does God see when God look at us? When does God see when God look at me? Regardless of the situation I have, regardless of what I'm going through, regardless of my challenges, regardless of what has happened to me, what does God see? The scripture clearly reveals to us what God see when God look at his children. God see what you are in the spirit. God see who you are in the spirit. So when God look at me, now pay attention, this is important. So what does God see? All right. God see who he has made me to become in Christ. So when God look at me, now pay attention to this. God see who or what he has called me in Christ Jesus. That is important. So seeing where is seeing what God has called me. Seeing where is seeing what God is seeing in the spirit. Seeing where is seeing exactly the image, the posse, the new creation that God is seeing in Christ. That is what seeing well is. So seeing well is you seeing what God sees. And what does God see? God see only who he has made you in Christ. God see only what I am in Christ. God see only what he has called me in Christ. So who or what has God made me in Christ? Who or what has God called me in Christ? He called me below. So when God look at me, even when I just finish messing up, I just make a huge mistake. Do you know what God see? Do you know who God see? A beloved. Glory be to God. Colossians chapter 3 verse 12, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, that is what God sees. That is who God sees. So seeing where is me, seeing myself as one loved by God, as a beloved of God, at all time, not only when I do what is right, not only when I have done something good, but at all time, if I'm a child of God, if I believe in Christ Jesus, I am God's beloved, loved unconditionally by God. And when God look at me, God sees his elect, God sees his chosen one, God sees his beloved. And listen to me, if I am looking at myself, and that is not what I'm seeing, then I am not seeing well. Are you following me? 1 Corinthians 6:11. So when God look at you, what does God see? If you are a believer, if you are a child of God, God see one who is righteous, forgiving, justified, sanctified, holy, one who is accepted. That is what God see. 1 Corinthians 6:11. And such were some of you, but you were washed. So that's what God sees. When God look at me, God does not see a dirty, rotten, stinking sinner. No, God see one who is washed. God see one who is sanctified. God see one who is justified. God see one who is forgiven. Glory be to God. Is that what you see when you look at yourself? If that is not what you are seeing, now that means you are not seeing well. If you don't see exactly what God is seeing, and what does God see? God only see what he made me in Christ. God only see what he called me in Christ. And do you know what he called me? He called me washed. He called me sanctified. Holy, set apart. Glory be to God. He called me accepted. Overcomer, more than conqueror. He called me anointed, blessed, joint us with Christ, risen, exalted, seated with Christ at his right hand. Glory be to God. Romans 8:37. Yet in all these things, we are more than conqueror. Glory. So when God look at me, all right, even though I'm still struggling with something, are you listening to what I'm talking about? Now, what does God see? God does not see a vanquished. God does not see someone defeated. No. Listen to me. God sees more than conqueror. God sees an overcomer. So when I look at myself, in spite of the addiction, in spite of the sin and the sinful habit I'm still struggling with. Now, if I don't see myself as more than conqueror, if I don't see myself as an overcomer, you know what? I am not seeing well. And guess what? I will not be able to live well. Now, we're still going to get that. Why it is important to see well? If you don't see well, you will be a major hindrance to what God is doing. If you don't see well, like Jeremiah, you will always say, I cannot. All right? If you don't see well, you'll not be able to live well. It is important to see well. And when we get there, we're going to deal more with that. But it is important to know that seeing well is seeing exactly what God sees. And we are saying, what does God see? God sees who you are in the spirit. God sees what he has made you in Christ. What does God see? God sees handiwork. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? When God look at me, God is not looking at an helpless, powerless person. No. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, 21:22, 2 Corinthians. Do you know when God, what God see? When God look at me. Even though at times I feel so helpless, I feel so powerless, I feel like there is nothing good in me, I feel like I'm weak, but you know when God look at me, God see one who is anointed. God see one who is empowered. God see one who has the resurrection power of God inside of him. Glory be to God. 2 Corinthians 1:21-22. Now he who establishes us with you in Christ and has anointed us is God. Hallelujah. So when God look at me, he sees he's anointed. He's anointed. That's what God sees. What do you see? When you look at your life, do you see an anointed of the Lord? Empowered of the Lord, equipped of the Lord, exalted of the Lord, seated together with Christ at the right hand of the Lord. Is that what you see? If what you see just a failure, a victim, a helpless person, you are not seeing well. That is not what God is seeing. If you're a child of God, God is seeing one who is blessed, one who is redeemed from every call. When you look at your life, what do you see? Do you see someone who is cursed? Someone who is struggling under a curse? You are not seeing well. If you are a believer, if you are a child of God, you are redeemed from the call. So when God look at you, you see one who is blessed. When God look at you, you see a heir of God, a joint heir with his son, Christ Jesus. Isn't that awesome? So seeing well, I cannot overemphasize that. Seeing well is seeing exactly what God is saying. And what is God saying? Who and what he has made me in Christ Jesus. That is only what God sees. In spite of my situation, in spite of my struggles, in spite of my challenges, it doesn't matter how many enemies are against me. It doesn't matter the wall that is on my way. God sees more than conqueror, an overcomer, undefeated one. That's what God sees. Glory be to God. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Very interesting account there. We are still on. What does it mean to see well? And seeing well is seeing what God sees. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, you know the story very well. Now, that is the king of Assyria. Now, he sent an army to capture, to arrest the prophet of God, Elisha. All right? He was so mad with Elisha because Elisha was always revealing his secret and his strategy to the king of Israel. All right? So he sent his army. Look at what happened. Let's jump on it because of time. 2 Kings chapter 6, 15 and 17. And when the servant of the man of God, so this servant of Elisha, so he arose early and he went out. Now, look at what he saw. So there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And so look at the response of the servant of the prophet. And his servant said to him, "Alas, my master, what shall we do? We are surrounded. We are about to be captured. We are about to be defeated. We are about to be devoured. We are about to be killed. We are about to be taken as captive. That is all I see." All right? Okay, so let's see what Elisha saw. So Elisha answered, "Do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them." Those who are with us are more than those who are with them. I believe the servant of the prophet of God will have said, are you blind or what? Look around us. We are surrounded. We are surrounded. Horses and chariots and army. They are not here to entertain us. They are here to capture us. But listen to Elisha. All right. Elisha prayed and said, verse 17, "Lord, I pray, open his eye that he may see." He was not physically blind, but he was spiritually impaired, blind. He was not seeing what God was seeing. He was not seeing what his master Elisha was seeing. What was Elisha seeing? What God has shown him. What did God show Elisha? Let's see. "Then the Lord opened the eyes of this young man, and he saw." So what did he see? "And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha." Can you see? I believe even before the army of Syria came, God had already shown his prophet Elisha how his presence, how he has giving charge to his angels with chariot of fire and horses to always go with him, to encamp around about him, to surround him, to protect him. God had already shown that to Elisha, and that is what Elisha was saying. That is a spiritual reality, and that was what Elisha was fixated upon. But the servant of Elisha was fixated upon the natural reality. His eyes was glued. His eyes was fixed. His eyes was set only on what he could see in the natural. And that was why he was afraid. But the moment his eyes were open and he saw the spiritual reality and he saw beyond the natural, no more fear. No more fear. Now, do you see what it means to see where? What it means to see where is to see spiritual reality. Your spiritual reality in Christ. What does it mean to see where? Is to see that wherever you go, God's presence is with you. His angels have been assigned to encamp around about you, to surround you as mountains surround Jerusalem. That means no evil come near you, no plague come near you. Glory be to God. Do you see that? The servant of Elisha did not see that. It took a while for him to see that. Now, listen to this. You need to see that. So, if your eyes are glued to your natural reality, circumstances, situation, all that you see is the doctor's diagnosis and prognosis, what the doctor has said, oh, you're not going to make it, there's no cure for this, and that is all you see, and that is all you are thinking upon, but you don't see that by stripes you are healed. You don't see that the Lord has took your infirmity upon himself. You don't see that he bore your sin. He bore your sicknesses in his body. You don't see that the number of your years you will fulfill. That you will not die but live and declare the good work of the Lord. That means you are not seeing well. You are not seeing well. So, if my eyes are only glued to my physical, natural challenges, the physical, natural fact, and circumstances, and not what God says, and not what God has for me in the spirit, my spiritual reality in Christ, I am not seeing well. Let's take this before we close. What does it mean to see well? I told you two things. First, seeing well is seeing exactly what God is seeing. And what is God seeing? Every time he looks at you, God only see what you are in Christ, what he has made you in Christ, what he has given you in Christ. That is important. God see my spiritual reality. And if I see them, then I'm seeing well. Is somebody listening to what I'm talking about? Glory be to God. So what does it mean to see well? Seeing well is seeing as God see. Now listen to it. I told you earlier that seeing well is seeing what God sees, but it is not just seeing what God sees, it is seeing what God sees, how God sees it. So seeing well is not just seeing what God sees, but seeing it just as God sees it. Seeing well is seeing it just as God sees it. What does that mean? Seeing well is seeing through God's lens. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? So seeing well is you putting on God's lens and you can see what God sees. You can see how God sees. That is what seeing well is. Seeing well is you seeing from God's standpoint. Is you seeing from God's perspective. That is what it means to see well. Seeing well is you having God's mindset, God's mentality and outlook. Seeing well is you seeing things and interpreting it the exact way that God will interpret it. Is somebody listening to what I'm talking about? That is what seeing well is. So, if God is saying, look at this, alright? And I see it, and God asked me to describe it. And you listen to what I'm talking about. And my description does not 100% match with God's description. Even though I am seeing what God is showing me, I am not seeing it as God sees it. And you listen to what I'm talking about. I'm not seeing it how God sees it. I am not interpreting it as God will interpret or describe it. That means I'm not seeing well. So the question is, how does God see things? That is important. What is God's mindset? What is God's mentality? What is God's outlook? We are saying, what does God, when you see through God's lens, what do you see? That is exactly what God sees and how God sees it. So what does that mean? The scripture revealed to us that God does not see as a man sees. That is important. Seeing well is seeing what God sees and how God sees it. Are you listening to me? That is important. If that is all we could cover today, it's worth it. So seeing well is seeing what God sees and how God sees it. So how does God see, or rather, how does God not see? God does not see as a man see. Man sees, man judges, man evaluates and regards things according to the flesh. But God sees beyond the flesh. Are you listening to me? Of course, let's jump to 1 Samuel chapter 16. Let's quickly learn from the prophet of God, Samuel, all right? So this is Samuel. God has made up his mind to replace the first king of Israel, Saul, all right? God had a man that he had chosen. And so Samuel was sent to anoint the man that God has chosen. So Samuel showed up in the house of Jesse. Listen to it. And seven sons were presented to Samuel. But Samuel had not put on God's lamb. So when Samuel first saw, he saw as a natural man. What did he see? So it was when they came. So seven sons came. Then he looked at Eliab, the first son, and he said, surely, verily, no doubt, the Lord's anointed is before me. All right. That was Samuel without God's lens. That was Samuel seeing as a man sees. That was Samuel seeing, interpreting, judging and evaluating according to the flesh, according to the look, according to the stature, according to the physical appearances. All right. So now look at what happened. So the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his appearance. You are looking at the wrong thing. Do not look at his physical stature. God is saying, put on your spiritual lens. Put on my lens. That is not the way I see. All right. So God said, do not look at his appearance or at his physical stature because I am refusing. For the Lord does not see as man sees. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. God see beyond the flesh. God see beyond the action. And you listen to what I'm talking about. He does not see according to the flesh. So that is the way God sees. All right. Let's look at one or two more passage before we close. Numbers chapter 13. You remember the story very well. 12 spies were sent by Moses to spy out the promised land, the land of Canaan. All right. And when they came back. All right. Look at 31. 10 of them says, we are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. They are referring to the giant they saw. But because they did not see through God's lens, they did not see from God's standpoint, they did not see from God's perspective, they were not seeing with God's mentality and mindset, they came to a wrong conclusion. The conclusion is, we are not able to go up against it. We can't make it. We can't do it. All right? That's what happens when you don't have God's lens on, when you are not seeing as God sees, when you are not seeing the way God sees, when you are not seeing through God's lens, when you are not seeing from God's perspective. You will always say, oh, I cannot do that. Oh, I can't have that. I can't get that. Oh, I can't make that. It is because you are not putting on the right lens. All right. Now look at what it says in verse 3. There we saw the giant. All right. The descendant of Anak came from the giant, and we were like grasshoppers in our own side, so we were in their side. That's very interesting. So that tells us all what they put on was the lens of the giant. So they saw themselves how the giant saw them. The giant looked at them and saw them like grasshopper. And when they also put on the giant lens, they saw themselves as grasshopper. Isn't that what the enemy also do to us? The enemy offer you his own lens. And you see yourself through the lens of the enemy. A failure, an addict. You see yourself abandoned, not loved by anyone, forsaken. You see yourself helpless, poor, powerless. Do you know what is wrong with you? You are seen through the enemy's lens. You need to throw away that lens. You need to put on your God lens and begin to see yourself just as God sees you. Glory be to God. Thank God for Joshua and Caleb. They were wearing the lens of God. They were putting on the lens of the word of God. They saw themselves through the lens of God. And look at what they said. Let me jump to verse 9. They told them, only do not rebel against the law, nor fear the people of the land, for they are our bread. They were referring to the giant. Their protection has departed from them. The Lord is with all. Do not fear them. Do you know what Joshua and Caleb were saying? Giants, we saw them like bread. Can you imagine? How is that possible? It is only possible when you see from God's standpoint. It is only possible when you see from the position God has placed you. Raised together with Christ, exalted and seated at the right hand of the Father. So when I look down from that exalted position, I see my challenges, I see my enemy, I see my obstacle just as bread. When you are looking at them from the natural plane, you may see them as giants, but I am not seen from the natural plane. I am seen from an exalted position in Christ. So they are our bread. I check out that in different Bible rendition. Very beautiful. New Living Translation says, they are helpless prey. Now, Goodness Bible says, we shall conquer them easily. It was referring to giant. Message Bible says, we shall have them for lunch. Isn't that funny? International Children Bible says, we will chew them up. In fact, NIV say, we will devour them. That was Joshua and Caleb speaking. Why? Because they were seeing how God sees. God will not look at a giant. God will say, these are giant. No, God will see them as bread. Nothing. Helpless prey. And when you put on God's lens, you see your sickness just the same way God sees it. As bread. Oh, they said, but that is cancer. That is incurable. That is asthma. You say, no. I am not seeing it as incurable. I am seeing it as nothing. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? You will see it as something you will defeat easily. You will see it as something you will just chew up and devour. Just like Joshua and Caleb saw the giant. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. So what am I saying to you? Enough of seeing from human point of view. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Let's take two more scriptures and then we pray. Glory be to God. You need to begin to see in the spirit. God sees you in the spirit. So you need to see yourself as God sees you in Christ, as God sees you in the spirit. You need to put on the lens of the word of God and you see yourself, you see your challenges, you see your situation in the light of the word of God. Are you listening to what I'm talking about? When you are born again, you are not the same person you used to be. No, things have changed. Glory be to God. If you are born again, Things have changed. Hallelujah. Look at what the Bible says about you. Glory be to God. Let's quickly take this before we close. Glory be to God. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 16 and 17. New King James, Paul said, therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we have known Christ according to the flesh. Yet, we know him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. That's the way you see yourself. Not the same old person you used to be before Christ came into your heart. You are a new person now. See yourself as one that is with Christ. One spirit with Christ. As he is, 1 John 4:17. So are we in this world. So are you now. That is the way God sees you. And that is the way you see yourself. You are put on Christ. Christ is now your identity. Seeing well is seeing Christ. Seeing well is seeing yourself in Christ. If you see Christ raised, exalted at the right hand of the Father, and you can see Christ in his glory, in his power, in his majesty, that is where you are. That is what you see about yourself. See yourself in Christ. That is the way God sees you. So you're not about seeing yourself just as you used to see yourself. You are now a believer. You are born again. You are a new creation in Christ. God has placed you in Christ. Christ has become your identity. Begin to see yourself as God sees you in Christ Jesus. We're going to stop there. And next week, we're going to continue. I hope you are blessed. Glory be to God. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Father, because we are beginning to see well. Just as you see, we are beginning to see what you see when you look at us. We are beginning to see who you see when you look at us. We are beginning to see exactly how you see when you look at us. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you because we are putting on your lens and we are going to see our enemy, our sickness, challenges, situation, just as you see them, as prey, as nothing. Glory be to God. Father, we thank you. We give you praise. We give you glory. And in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
We hope you have been challenged, encouraged and motivated to become more like Christ by today's teaching. If you would like to find out more about Eras of Revival and get additional teachings and materials for your healthy spiritual growth, visit our website today at www.erasofrevival.org. Or if you would like to enroll at our School of Discipleship, visit our website www.theschoolofdiscipleship.org.uk. This teaching was made possible by the prayers and generous free will offering, donation, and gifts from partners like you. You are welcome into partnership with us today. For information on how to become a partner, please call 1-868-292-9270. Or 1-866-703-5572. Or you can email us at info@erasofrevival.org.uk. Thanks for listening.